Good evening, good afternoon, good day, depending on where you are in the world when you listen to this. Hello, this is Cleo. About an hour ago or so, I put on Facebook the caption that said, black children and adults who have accurate critical analysis about white supremacy and patriarchy tend to have less tend to be less at risk for self-hate and being misogynist. And I've literally tested this, so it's not just a theory. But I'm gonna try to tell you a story that I think kind of contextualizes what I mean. It's one of many, but it's one of my favorites because I think it's one of the first stories that helped me to realize the poignant power of something I call CTCA, which stands for Critical Thinking and Culture Affirmation, which is a methodology I developed some years ago that a center that I ran for 15 years called the Amasi Center in Los Angeles, and we had a center in Oakland as well, implemented to help black folks. Amasi stands for the African American Advocacy Support Services Survival Center. And in short, we would call it the Amasi Wellness and Cultural Center. Anyway, I'm gonna try to be brief here so I won't bore you with no long story. One of the more popular programs that we had at the Amasi Center was Watu Wajua. Watu Wajua stands for Children of the Sun in Swahili. We had a project on the weekends along with tutoring programs for black children. And the Watu Wajua project taught black children how to decode the society they lived in, how to have a critical analysis of the world that they live in, and how to evaluate everything around them to make sure that they weren't internalizing negative messages because the society is so full of negative messages. As a matter of fact, one of the exercises that we did two that were particularly powerful, one that's relevant to my story, but one of the things we used to do was ask the children to bring magazines, any magazines they wanted. And they would bring in Life magazine, they would bring in Jet magazine, they would bring in some of the teenage magazines, I forgot the name of them, but they usually were white kids on these magazines, and bring in all the any kind of material they wanted to the class. And they would be asked, okay, what in this material makes you feel good about yourself? And in most cases, they found very little that made them feel good about themselves. There were exceptions, but more than not, they didn't find much that made them feel good about themselves, about being a person of African descent. So one of the parts of our strategy was we never told people what to think or gave them any kind of, we never tried to get them to think a certain kind of way. We just wanted them to actually think about what's their surroundings. So they would look at these materials and they would really see themselves, and they would really refer to black people as beautiful. The people they always called beautiful in most cases were white people or light-skinned black people. We also did the doll test, and the doll test came out very similar to the Clark's version way back in the 30s, and the same thing that happened in recent films and recent doll tests. Most of the children saw the white doll is better than black. We also show films, and to make a long story, we use different types of material to get them to examine and critically look at the world around them. And we did all types of exercises that involve triggering the critical thinking capacity, critical analysis capacity, and ability among the young people to decode their environment and to unlearn anti-black mythology, and to learn black affirming facts about being black, and to recognize, internalize white supremacy when it was happening with them. And we had great success with that. Now I'm gonna get to the example of what I mean by great success, and where I'm gonna try to make this story long and not get emotional about it. In the mid-90s, I think it was, I was sitting in a park called Leimert Park. If you're from Los Angeles, you know where Leimert Park is. It's in the Crenshaw District, which back then was a predominantly black community. It's since changed. It's now becoming more white and more Latino. But back in the day, it was a historically black community. We had Magic Johnson theaters and, you know, a lot of things that were iconic to a black community. And it was a really beautiful day. And I lived only three blocks from this, in an area called Baldwin Hills. And I was only a few blocks from this park. Anyway, I was in the park, chilling in the sun, but I had on an Imasi Center t-shirt. And the Imasi Center t-shirt had a big round emblem and the word Imasi around. It was a pretty bright symbol, which I may show to you at some point. Anyway, I was listening to some music and I had my headphones on. And suddenly I saw these two young people coming my way. I assessed that they might have been 16 and 17. They were clearly a couple because they had their arm around each other. They were young, two young black kids. So they came up to me, to my surprise, and they pointed at me and asked me a question. I couldn't hear them at first because I had on headphones. I took them off and they finally said, "Are you that guy from Amalfi?" And some people often get the word Amasi mispronunciated. And they did that day. They said, "Are you that guy from Amalfi?" And I said, "You mean Amasi?" Because it was written on my shirt, so I don't know why they said Amalfi. But anyway, they said Amasi. Yeah, Amasi. Yeah, that's right, that is on your shirt. Exactly. So they said, "It's interesting to see you here because we were just talking about your program and talking about you." And I'm eager to hear this because I didn't recognize these two young people. To make a long story short, they were 16. Both of them were 16 years old. When they were 10 years old, they used to go to the Watu Wajua program at the Imasi Center in Inglewood. And they had learned how to decode white supremacy and anti-black implications in media. A film had just come out starring Queen Latifah and I think Steve Martin. I've never seen the film, but it was called Burning Up a House or Burning Down the House or something about a house and something. And the film starred Queen Latifah and Steve Martin and some others. And they said, when we watched the film, we thought about you in the Imasi Center and what we learned. They said, we realized that Queen Latifah's character never had a positive relationship with anybody black, that all the black men in the picture in the movie were criminals, that the people that treated her best and that she was the most happy with or around were white folks, and that the picture was literally implying that being black was bad and being white was better. And we caught them, we saw it, we saw what they were doing, and we realized that this film, if we didn't go to the Watu Wajua class, would have had us, like many other films before, questioning our worth, because they said straight up, they said, "Our parents didn't teach us what we learned at Watu Wajua. We watched films with our family that were very anti-black, and we ate popcorn and enjoyed it and went home. There was no critical analysis of what we just experienced. But because of the Watu Wajua program and them learning about media literacy, decoding white supremacy messaging, unlearning anti-black norms and impulses, and doing something that I call the benefit factor, meaning are your decisions, are your impulses, is your behavior in benefit of you as a black person or detrimental to you as a black person? Always be considerate of that when you make your next move." All of that stuff that they had learned at 10 years old was still with them 6 years later. And I did cry, I did tear up a little bit during the conversation, and they seemed to understand why, because they both started dabbing my face. It was so cute, this little young couple. But that is an example of the power of critical analysis. It's an example of what critical analysis preparation looks like and what critical analysis implementation looks like. I could go on and on and on, but the reason I'm even telling you guys all of this is because after I put that panel up on Facebook about the importance of critical analysis, I kept getting messages going, "What's critical analysis? You often reference critical analysis. What is that?" They said that they looked it up on Facebook or on Google, and it wasn't black specific, so they didn't understand what I was saying. So now that I told you about Watu Wajua, the Children of the Sun, in what Swahili word that entitled our youth program on the weekends at the Imasi Center, and told you about the different elements of the curriculum and the outcome of it in terms of these young people having seen this film called Burning Down Something with Queen Latifah, I think I'll give you an example of what critical analysis looks like and what it is like when people embody it. And these are two black children who truly loved each other, who both were clearly black, not ambiguously black, who clearly valued each other and valued themselves as black people. And I think one of the main reasons they were able to do that, despite their parents' lack of attention in this regard, was you can't unring a bell. And once they got the main elements of critical thinking and culture affirmation, and we use materials that they brought in to evaluate that were part of their landscape, that they never looked at the same again after our workshop, which lasted about 3 weeks, their life was changed and their black affirming or pro-black light was turned on. So in case you have any more questions about critical analysis, feel free to ask, but I hope this video answers your questions. Thanks for listening. Bye. And I must tell you that my book will be coming out this year, which is based on CTCA. My book is called Getting Woke, An Instructional Guide to Making Black America Great Again. So when it's on the shelves or near the shelves or on the Amazon, wherever it's going to be, I will surely let you know. And there's more to learn about the work CTCA and the importance of critical analysis and the importance of black people having a critical analysis about white supremacy myth and patriarchy, so they won't fall for the okey-doke and they won't sit passively and internalize these negative messages that are harmful to the black psyche and to how we treat each other and how we see each other as black people and how we treat women and how we treat men. Thanks for listening. Be well. I'll talk to you soon. Bye.